forests have no greater enemy than fire. The clean forest air is rich in oxygen, and the continuing cycle of growth brings leaves and bark to the forest floor, fuel for a conflagration. A spark provides the heat to complete the fire triangle and unleash that awesome terror, forest fire. It calls for skilled, trained forest firefighters to break the triangle. This is the basic manual of fire control techniques used to stop the flames and guard the fire area until it's black out. The spark becomes a flame, the smoke is sighted, and the alarm sounded. When the first fire crews attack, it's their aim to cut off fuels from the fire. They do this by clearing a line around it. This line must then be patrolled and held. Mopping up is next. Burning material inside the line is stirred, cooled, and extinguished. The patrol continues until the fire is safe. So there are four steps used to control forest fires. First, construct a fire line around the fire. Second, patrol the fire line. Third, mop up. And finally, patrol the fire until it's safe. The rake hoe, the most important weapon in the forest firefighter's armory. A combination of a rake and a hoe. It's used to build the fire line, a gap in the fuel supply on the forest floor that the fire cannot cross. The removal of leaves and twigs is done with the rake teeth. The fuel is always raked away from the oncoming fire, except when it's required to start a backfire. The second stage is the removal of grass and topsoil until bare earth is exposed. This is done with the chipping edge of the rake hoe. Another way, known as the Dalesford method, is to first chip to bare earth for one blade width parallel to the fire edge. Later cuts are made at about 60 degrees to this first chipped line. This method is easier in many soil types as it gives a cut edge to work from and a straight edge on the fire side of the fuel break. Other hand tools are used to remove heavier fuels ahead of the rake hoe. The fern hook cuts bracken and light scrub close to the ground. In medium and heavy scrub, the heavier slasher is required. Cut material is thrown away from the fire edge. Another supporting tool that can be carried in a sheath on a crew member's belt is the machete. This allows a man to rake as well as cut scrub. The axe is used in heavier timber for cutting out spars and logs. A gap is made through these about twice the width of the fire line. Larger timber and dry logs may be removed with a chainsaw. Removal of all spars on the fire line can save much mopping up and patrol work later. close together, accidents are likely to happen, especially when they pass each other to get to a new section of fire line. The need to move through uncut and tangled scrub on either side of the fire line also causes needless fatigue. There's a much better way, the step-up method of fire line construction. Each man maintains his same position in the crew lineup. The crew leader moves ahead, marking the direction of the fire line. The crew follows, with the men spaced about 12 paces apart. When one man completes his section, he calls, "Step up!" And all the men in front of him move ahead to a new section of trail. At his own pace. No passing is necessary, and the spacing between men is always enough for safe working. The last man in the crew, the polisher, is responsible for the standard and the final completion of the fire line. The finer points of fire line construction have been learned through years of hard experience by firefighting crews. If a log of this size must be included within the fire line, and it's too large to remove with the tools available, then removal of the bark will prevent the fire crossing the line easily. All inflammable material must be removed, especially the fuel from underneath the log. All the material removed is thrown away from the fire. Where the fire line passes close to a large tree, such as this one, leaves and dry fuel must be removed completely from around the trunk. A few minutes' work before the fire reaches the tree will save much work later. If this tree caught alight, it may have to be felled during mopping up procedures. The fuel is removed right down to the bare earth. Make the fire line wide enough to stop the fire, especially at bends in the fire line where there's more danger of the fire leaping across the cleared gap. clothing fashions don't change much for forest firefighters. Strong leather boots, woolen socks, heavy work trousers, and a shirt of woolen or cotton drill are required. Nothing less. Sleeves are rolled down while working close to flames and sparks. Plastic goggles are issued and should be worn to protect the eyes when working in dense smoke. The safety helmet is a must. Worn on the fire line, it offers protection from radiant heat, from falling branches and head injuries. It's also a good place to carry this light, expendable smoke mask to be worn when necessary in dense smoke. Some essentials are always carried in the pockets. A knife, matches, and, no, that's not tobacco, it's a first aid tin. Ample food and drinking water must be taken by the crew to the fire area. Each crew should have a bag containing first aid supplies, torch, and a file. The bag should also contain spare torch batteries and a sharpening stone. Now to get down to the job of fighting the fire. The direct attack method is used where the flames of the fire are low and the terrain is not rough or steep. This method keeps fires to the smallest area and should be used wherever possible. Even without tools, a direct attack on low flames can be made. Many fires have been kept small by prompt action of passers-by. Direct attack may also be made with a knapsack. Water is directed along the burning edge, right at the base of the flames. Water sprayed onto burnt ground or fuel too far ahead of the flames is wasted. Although the knapsack is effective in knocking down flames, it should be followed with a rake hoe to be sure the fire is out. But when the flame height is excessive, or the fire is burning in inaccessible country, the indirect method of attack is used. In this method, the fire line is located in light fuel away from the fire edge, and the area of fuel between the fire line and the advancing fire edge is burned out with a backfire. In this event, the light fuel may be raked toward the advancing fire and used as fuel to light the backfire. Of course, on any one wildfire, both the direct and indirect methods of attack may be used in combination as required. As soon as the fire burns to the edge of the fire line, the patrol begins. The aim of the patrol is to make sure that the fire does not cross the fire line behind the crew. Patrolmen work best in pairs, moving along the fire line, locating and eliminating any danger points or spot fires that have crossed the line. Patrol of the fire line is a security measure to hold all that's been gained by the fire line construction. Careless patrol may cause the failure of the whole operation. When the fire is checked by the completed fire line, the next phase is mopping up. Every hot spot on the fire edge must be found and put out. Mopping up proceeds until all the fire edge and a safe distance into the burnt area has been made secure by the elimination of all hot spots. Hot spots are more readily located while they're still smoking. Systematic location and marking of hot spots makes later detection by work crews easier and faster. Elevated hotspots can be dealt with most effectively by felling the tree. The only way of making sure these hazards are eliminated is by physically cutting out the burning material. Even if water were available, this procedure would still be necessary to make sure the hot spot was opened up and put out. Burning logs are split open and the seat of the fire raked out. Once a hot spot of this type has been opened up and spread out, the concentration of heat is removed and the scattered coals will burn out. Hot spots also occur below ground level. These have to be dug out. The last trace of burning material must be removed. Old roots can smolder underground for days and then surface on the unburnt side of the fire line. Final feel for hot spots, make sure that no burning roots are left. Often, small spars burn through at the base and fall across the fire line. Unless these are removed promptly, they provide a bridge for the fire to cross over. Some hot spots can be put out without completely removing the tree or stump. Good use of the axe and rake hoe will remove the burning outer layers of the bark, leaving sound timber exposed. The application of a small amount of water directly onto the hot spot will put it out. It's often been demonstrated in practice that trained men, correctly dressed and equipped with hand tools, can very effectively deal with quite severe forest fire. It's through efficient line construction, vigilant patrol, and thorough mopping up that they accomplish their aim, a fire blackout.